After studying this model, you will be able to know about various categories of indirect taxes which are prevalent in India. Secondly, you will understand how agriculture sector is taxed in India. And lastly, through this module, you will learn about the expenditure taxation which is prevalent in India. Now, first of all, let us discuss the classification of indirect taxes. Indirect taxes are different from direct taxes in a way that in case of indirect taxes, the incidence as well as impact does not fall on the same person. Rather, incidence and impact falls upon two different persons. A person who is taxed bears the impact of tax, but the final burden, which is also known as incidence of the tax, falls on the second person. That means in case of indirect tax, tax shifting can take place. These taxes are imposed on different groups of people, but the liability remains on the person who eventually collects it. The indirect taxes paid by the taxpayer is recovered from the consumers and clients eventually and is finally paid to the government. Some of the indirect taxes are imposed by the central government, and there are some others which are imposed by the state government. The rates of the taxes which are imposed by the state government differ from state to state. That means in case of state governments, we do not have a uniform rate of indirect taxes, and there will be difference across states. Some of the indirect taxes which are levied by the governments in Indian states are sales tax, which is now replaced by VAT or value added tax, excise duty, custom duty, service tax, etc. Among the examples which I just gave you, custom duty, excise duty and the service tax are the central taxes. That means these are the taxes which are imposed by the central government, while the VAT is an example of a tax which is imposed by the state government. Now, one by one, let us discuss these indirect taxes in detail. First of all, I am going to talk about VAT, which is nothing but modified form of sales tax. A sales tax is a consumption tax which is imposed at the time of purchase of certain goods and services. Here the word purchase is very important because we are not talking about manufacturing, rather we are talking about the final sale of the product. That is why we are using the word purchase here. The government of a country imposes tax on specific goods and services. Sales tax are collected by the sellers, who in turn remit the amount of tax collected under sales tax to the government agencies. Sales tax is mostly charged on the sale of goods, but there are several services which also come under the ambit of sales tax. Now, sales tax is supplemented by another tax known as VAT or value added tax, so as to make it uniform across the country. Before VAT or value added tax was introduced in India in 2002, sales tax was prevalent in Indian economy. The sales tax which is charged by the center is known as CST or central sales tax. CST still comprises the most significant source of revenue to the central government. The sales tax which is levied by the states is called as state sales tax, but now the state's sales tax has been replaced by another tax known as VAT or value added tax. One problem associated with sales tax was the phenomena of cascading effect. That is an effect which increased the tax burden at various stages up to the end user or the final consumer. This implies that the same tax rate applies to the each stage of production. So the burden of tax falls heavily like a cascade on the final consumer. That is why it was important to replace sales tax with the new tax, so that a person pays tax only on the value which he is adding and not on the final price at each and every stage. Therefore, sales tax was replaced by VAT or value added tax. some of the chief advantages of value added tax over sales tax are, firstly, the burden of tax on the final consumer is much lesser. Secondly, it avoids repeating tax on the product. As I just explained, the concept of cascading, that is where the same tax is already included. Therefore, the burden on the producer is also less. Thirdly, it reduces the compliance cost and administrative cost. Compliance cost is the cost which a person pays when he decides to pay the tax, while the administrative cost is the cost to collect the taxes. Lastly, it decreases the tendency of tax evasion because it is very difficult to evade tax under VAT due to reduced tax burden, and hence government revenue is also expected to rise as a result of value added tax. VAT in India was initiated at the central level for a particular group of commodities through the modified value added tax scheme, also known as Mod VAT scheme, in basically 1st March 1986. It was converted to a central value added tax, that is Mod VAT was converted into a Sen VAT in the year 2002. Likewise, state sales tax has been replaced by a state level value added tax. Going ahead with tax reforms, the government is set to roll out the goods and services tax, which is also known as GST, which would give states the right to tax goods up to the retail stage. And though presently the right has been limited to the manufacturing stage only. Central sales tax, that is CST, is usually payable on the sale of all goods by a dealer in the form of interstate trade or commerce outside a state, or the way of import into or export from India. The ceiling rate of CST, a tax on interstate sale of goods, is 3%. Since April 1st, 2005, most of the state governments of India have replaced their sales tax with the new VAT, that is value added tax. Now, let me tell you about the rates of value added tax. The rates of VAT on several commodities are even for all the states and union territories. That means homogeneous rates are being charged. There are two basic rates of 4% and 12.5% besides an exempted category and a special rate of 1% on certain commodities. There are four slabs of value added tax in India. As I told you that though homogeneous rates are there, there are certain slabs which have been introduced. First is the rate of 0% on basic necessities and essential commodities, a rate of 1% on gold, silver, bullion and precious stones, a rate of 4% on industrial inputs, capital goods and the items of mass consumption, and finally all other items come under the rate of 12.5%. There is also another category with a 20% floor rate of tax. Floor rate of tax means minimum 20% tax will be there on those commodities. This category includes items like motor spirit, that is petrol, diesel, aviation turbine fuel, tobacco and liquor. These tax rates vary from state to state, and it is totally discretion of the state to decide the rate of tax on these commodities. The second major indirect tax which we are going to discuss are the excise duty. Excise tax, most commonly known as excise duty, is imposed on the goods which are manufactured and consumed within the boundary of India. It is a single largest source of government revenue and is based on quantity, not on the value of the product. That means even if the manufactured product is not sold, excise duty will still be paid on the product. That is why it is based on the quantity and not on the price or value. It is one of the most renowned types of taxation in the country. Manufacturers of excisable products are liable to pay this tax, which is imposed on a wide range of manufactured commodities. It is an important source of government revenue and accounts for the largest collection of the central government as far as indirect taxes are concerned. Apart from central government, even for the state governments, excise duty gives the biggest or the largest contribution. Manufacturers are required to pay excise tax before the goods exit the factory. That is why I explained that these taxes are imposed at the manufacturing stage and not at the sales tax stage like VAT. State governments also levy excise duty on a few commodities including liquor. Excise duties are time and again imposed at higher rates on goods, the consumption of which are supposed to have adverse effects on public health and environment. Now, the various types of central excise duty which are collected in India are, firstly, the basic excise duty. It is a duty imposed as per Section 3 of the Central Excise and Salt Act 1944 at all excisable goods other than salt, which are manufactured in India at the rate set out in the schedule of the Central Excise Tariff Act 1985. Secondly, we have additional duty on excise. Section 3 of the additional duties on excise, which is on the goods of specific importance, Act 1957, authorizes the levy and collection in respect of the goods manufactured in the schedule of this act, which was passed in 1957. This is charged in lieu of sales tax and is shared among the central government and the state governments. These are imposed under various enactments for commodities like medicinal and toilet preparations, sugar, etc., and other industrial development, etc. Next, we have special excise duty. According to the Section 37 of the Finance Act 1978, special excise duty was concerned with all excisable goods on which there is a duty of basic excise duty under the Central Excise and Salt Act 1944. Since then, every year, the appropriate provisions of the Finance Act specify the special excise duty shall be or shall not be levied and collected during the relevant financial year. After special excise duty, I am going to talk about another type of duty, and that is known as anti-dumping duty or safeguard duty. For import of listed goods with a view to safeguard domestic industry from unfair injury, it would not be put on goods imported by 100% export-oriented units and units of free trade zones and special economic zones. On export of goods, anti-dumping duty is exempted only in the form of a special brand rate of drawback. Safeguard duties do not involve the discovery of unfair trade practice such as dumping or subsidy or on the part of the exporting country, but they need not discriminate between imports from various countries. Safeguard action is resorted to only if it has been recognized that a sudden upsurge in imports has instigated or threatened to instigate serious injury to the domestic industry, and that is why we go for special safeguard duties to protect our domestic industry. Most of the goods attract excise duty at the rate of 16%. Some goods also attract special excise duty and an added excise duty at the rate of 8% above the 16% excise duty. 2% education cess is also applicable on the aggregate of the duties of excise. Excise duty is charged on ad valorem basis on the maximum retail price in certain cases. The next type of indirect tax which we are going to talk about is custom duty. custom duty is one of the most significant tariffs in India and is regulated under the Customs Act of 1962. It is levied on imports and also on certain exports. From a revenue point of view, custom duty has limited importance. It is a kind of trade tax levied on imported and exported goods. An important purpose of this tax, other than revenue augmentation, is the prevention of illegal exports and illegal imports of goods. Custom or import duties are imposed by the central government of India on the goods imported into the India. The rate at which custom duty is imposable on the goods depends on the classification of goods, which is determined under the customs tariff. In line with supporting the custom duty and bringing it at par with ASEAN level, the government has decreased the peak custom duty from 12.5% to 10% for all goods other than agricultural products. However, the central government has the authority to usually exempt the goods from exempt goods of any specific description of the whole or any part of duties of customs leviable thereon. In addition, preferential or concessional rates of duty are also accessible under the several trade agreements. In India, the charge and the rate of custom duty are administered by the Customs Act 1962 and the Customs Tariff Act 1975. In India, imported goods attract basic custom duty, additional custom duty, and educational cess. The rate of basic custom duty are mentioned under the Tariff Act. The peak rate of basic custom duty has been abridged to 15% for industrial goods. Additional custom duty is equivalent to the excise duty payable on alike goods manufactured in India. Education cess of 2% is imposable on the aggregate of custom duty on imported products. Custom duty is evaluated on the transaction value of goods. Rates of custom duty are provided on the website of CBEC for goods which are imported from countries with whom India has entered into free trade agreement, such as Thailand, Sri Lanka, BIMSTEC, South Asian countries, and Mercosur countries. The next indirect tax which I am going to discuss is the service tax. Service tax was introduced in India in 1994. It spreads to the whole of India, excluding the state of Jammu and Kashmir. It is imposed and collected by the Union government. This is a tax collected from service providers. It is levied on the services rendered by specified categories of firms, persons, or agencies, and the government taxes them on the gross sum charged to the clients. It is an indirect tax as it can be recovered. That means the tax burden can be passed on to the consumer by the service provider in the course of business transaction. Initially, service tax, when it was announced in India, began with just three basic services, namely general insurance, stock broking, and telephone. Today, the service tax includes nearly 100 services on which service tax is levied. There has been a steady increase in the rate of service tax from a mere 5%. Now, service tax is imposed on a number of services, that is nearly 100 plus services, at the rate of 12%, and including the education cess of 3%, the effective rate of service tax eventually became 12.36%. Recently, in the latest budget, service tax has been increased to 14%, and on this 14%, another 2% will be charged as education cess. The next tax which we are going to discuss is the security transaction tax, or STT. Security transaction tax is imposed on the transactions. By transactions, we mean the sales and purchase carried out in the stock exchange in India. Securities transaction tax, also known as turnover tax, is a tax that is imposed on the taxable securities transactions. STT is imposable on the taxable securities transactions with effect from 1st October 2004 as per the notification issued by the central government. STT is valid on purchase or sale of several financial instruments like stocks, derivatives, mutual funds, etc. Current STT on the purchase or sale of an equity share is 0.075%. An individual becomes an investor after payment of STT at the time of selling securities. Selling the shares after 12 months comes under long-term capital gains, and one does not have to pay any tax on that gain. As I had told you in the previous module, capital gain tax for securities is exempted from tax. In the case of selling the shares before 12 months, one has to pay short-term capital gains at the rate of 10% flat on the gain. However, for a trader, all his gains will be treated as trading and he has to pay tax as per tax slabs. In this case, the transaction tax paid by him can be demanded back or adjusted in tax to be paid. In the end, we will discuss a very important tax known as Goods and Services Tax or GST. In the last 10 to 15 years, Indian taxation system has experienced remarkable modifications. The tax rates have been rationalized and tax laws have been simplified, leading to better compliance, ease of tax payment, and better enforcement. The procedure of rationalization of tax administration is ongoing in India. To simplify the complexities of the system of levies on goods and services, GST, that is goods and services tax, has been proposed in recent years. GST comprises of all taxes like service tax, excise tax, and value added tax, that is VAT. It shall cover the goods and services in almost all the sectors and in almost all the industries. The empowered committee of state finance ministers was assigned with the task of formulating a roadmap for the beginning of national level goods and services tax with effect from 1st April 2007. The action is towards the decrease of CST to 2% in 2008, 1% in 2009, and eventually 0% in 2010 to pave way for the introduction of the GST, and eventually it was done. The execution of GST is still not implemented, and till that time all the existing taxes would continue to be levied. Now, after discussing all the indirect taxes in detail, further we are going to talk about a separate tax, which is agriculture tax or tax on the income from agriculture. Section 10(1) of Income Tax Act exempts agriculture income from the tax from taxation. Section 21A defines agriculture income as, number 1, any rent or revenue derived from land which is situated in India and is used for agricultural purposes. Any income derived from such land by agricultural operations, including possessing of agricultural products, raised or received as rent in kind so as to render it fit for the market or sale of such produce. Thirdly, income attributable to a farmhouse subject to certain conditions. Fourthly, income derived from saplings or seedlings grown in a nursery are also exempted from agriculture tax. 35% to 25% of the income, as the case may be, is treated as business income in case of agriculture income tax, and rest is treated as agriculture income. Now let me explain in detail how we classify business income and agriculture income for various subsectors of agriculture. Firstly, growing and manufacturing tea in India, 40% income is considered to be business income and remaining 60% is considered to be agriculture income. Secondly, sale of latex or conex or latex based crepes or brown crepes manufactured from field latex or coal gum obtained from rubber plants grown by a seller in India, 35% of his total income from this activity will be considered as business income and remaining 65% will be considered as agriculture income and therefore will not be taxed. Sale of coffee grown and cured by a seller in India, 25% income will be considered as business income and the remaining 75% income will be considered as agriculture income. Sale of coffee grown, cured, roasted and grounded by a seller in India will eventually contribute 40% as business income and therefore it will be taxed, but the remaining 60% will be considered as agriculture income and therefore will not be taxed. The Finance Act 2000 introduced a new elucidation in Section 2(1)(a) to simplify that any revenue from such building or land arising from the use of building or land for any purpose other than agriculture would not be comprised in the definition of agricultural income and therefore that income will eventually be taxed. For example, if a person has income from using such building or land for purposes such as letting it out for residential purposes or for the purpose of any business or profession, then such income will be treated as non-agriculture income and therefore will be taxed from the year 2001-2002. The next tax which we are going to discuss is the expenditure tax. The expenditure tax is levied under the Expenditure Tax Act of 1987, which administered the taxation process linked with the chargeable expenditure incurred by an individual in a certain hotel or restaurant. The Act applies to chargeable expenditure provided the following criteria are fulfilled. The criteria which I am going to tell you are: number one, if the charges are incurred in a hotel where the room charges for an accommodation is INR 3000 per day or more than this sum. And secondly, the charges that are incurred in a restaurant. In instance of the room charges, the assessing officer of the income tax department has the autonomy to decide whether the charges are stated in the right way along with other respective charges such as food, drinks and other services. In the event that an inconsistency is found in the breakup of charges, the assessing officer is granted the right to decide on the sum needed to be charged as room charges. The expenditure tax taxable under this tax is charged at 10% of the charges incurred at a hotel as long as the hotel is as per clause 1 of the section 3 of Income Tax Act of 1961. And secondly, 15% on the charges incurred in a restaurant as long as the restaurant is as per clause 2 of the Section 3 of the Income Tax Act of 1961. In the end, let us summarize all which we have studied in this module. A taxpayer recovers the indirect taxes paid from their consumers and clients and finally pays the tax to the government. A sales tax is a consumption tax charged at the time of purchase of certain goods and services. The sales tax levied by the center is called Central Sales Tax or CST. The sales tax levied by the state government is called State's Sales Tax. Sales tax was found problematic due to its cascading effect, and therefore sales tax was eventually replaced by another tax known as VAT or Value Added Tax. Excise tax, more commonly known as excise duty, is imposed on the goods manufactured and consumed in India. Basically, it is a tax which is imposed on the manufacturing. Custom duty is levied on imports and on selective exports. It is a type of trade tax levied on imported and exported goods. An important purpose of this tax, other than revenue augmentation, is the prevention of illegal imports and exports of goods. Service tax was introduced in India in 1994, and it is levied and collected by the union government from the service providers. Service tax, when it was announced in India, started with merely 3 services, and now we have more than 100 services which are taxed in India. Securities transaction tax or STT, also known as turnover tax, is a tax that is imposable on the taxable securities transactions. STT is valid on purchase or sale of numerous financial products such as stocks, derivatives, mutual funds, etc. To simplify the complexities of the system of levies on goods and services, a comprehensive goods and services tax, GST, has been proposed in recent years. GST comprises of combination of all taxes like service tax, excise tax, and value added tax. Once implemented, it shall cover goods and services in almost all sectors and all industries. Further, we are going to talk about agriculture income tax, which is imposed on agriculture income, that is any rent or revenue which is received from land, which is located in India and is used for agriculture purposes. Agriculture income is exempted from tax as per the Section 10I of the Income Tax Act. Expenditure tax is charged if the charges are incurred in a hotel where the room charges for lodging is INR 3000 per day or exceeds this amount, or if the expenditure is made in a restaurant.